Welcome to the Pacific Research Institute's Next Round podcast. I'm Rowena Ichon, COO, and with me, as always, is Tim Anaya, Vice President of Marketing and Communications. So, Tim, a lot of excitement on the presidential race. We've got two additional candidates who finally made it official, Ron DeSantis and Tim Scott. So on the GOP side, we've got Trump, got Nikki Haley, Vivek Ramaswamy, Asa Hutchinson, California's Larry Elder, and for the Dems, there's Biden, Robert F. Kennedy Jr., and your favorite, Tim, Marianne Williamson.
Oh, so, I love that she's back.
So we haven't heard from Mike Pence, and just this past week, there's been a lot of speculation about Glenn Youngkin. So, you know, it's looking to be like a crowded field for the GOP. The polls seem to say that Trump has a huge lead, but to me, it's still early in the game. And I keep thinking of what R. Kerry Jackson said. He predicted that it would be from someone who none of us had ever thought about. Obviously, the example would be, imagine Donald Trump being the 45th president of the United States.
That's right.
No one could have predicted that one.
You know, these big announcements, you know, we always do our State of the Union. Sometimes we do our State of the State recap episodes. And I've called the State of the State, you know, you kind of are all dressed up with nowhere to go. It's a lot of work for that. And I think to a degree, these big puffed up announcements are kind of that. It's great for your camera crew to get good footage of you looking and sounding presidential. But remember, perhaps one of the best presidential announcements ever was Kamala Harris in the 2020 election. And that was the high water mark of her campaign. So we have to be a little cautious before making any pronouncement one way or another based on their announcement. But I will say this week brought very interesting contrasts, you know, where you have Tim Scott, who is running a very positive, hopeful campaign. What you kind of would expect, right? That you want your president to appeal to your best aspirations. The question, of course, is that what voters are looking for this year? We will certainly see. And then you had Ron DeSantis with kind of the worst kept secret in politics, you know, finally take the plunge. And he did it on Twitter in a thing called Twitter Spaces, which I didn't actually really know what Twitter Spaces was. And I tuned in and it was kind of a talk show kind of a thing co-hosted by Elon Musk. But he certainly drew a lot of attention for the technological flubs that were involved in this Twitter Spaces. Apparently, it was delayed by about a half an hour because, you know, they couldn't get this thing to launch. I feel like, you know, no one is going to care about those sorts of things within 48 hours of now. It's kind of an inside the beltway story. But certainly, you can't deny that all the buzz and all the interest is around Ron DeSantis. So now we'll see how he does when he gets out on the campaign trail this week.
We'll definitely be following all of this for our listeners as it unfolds. We've got, another year and a half until the election. So it could take lots of twists and turns. We've got a long podcast. So let's quickly move on to the budget. Got an update on that, Tim. The Assembly proposed its own budget. And in many ways, you know, as we talked about earlier, Newsom is the adult in the room, but the legislative analysts' office still think that the cuts aren't enough. They believe the deficit will be closer to $34-35 billion rather than the $31.5 billion that Newsom's office is forecasting. So what are you hearing?
Well, you know, as our Wayne Winegarden put it when the governor put out his May revise, you know, Newsom certainly rhetorically and for the most part in action is channeling his inner Jerry Brown. You know, he's not embracing new big expensive spending. There is some gimmickry in the Newsom. While there's some gimmickry in the Newsom plan, you know, for the most part, it's fairly realistic for what he wants to do in the times we face. But that still is not enough. If you read the LAO's report, it's very sombering. They recommend that, you know, the governor and legislators make another $6 billion in cuts this year. And a legislature that wants to spend more, as Senate Democrats do, they are going to have to be dragged kicking and screaming to that. So the Assembly has been largely silent 100% in this year's budget debate for now. We've seen a little bit of rumbling. Speaker Rendon came out and intimated that he thought we should use the rainy day fund reserve this year to reduce the severity of some of the cuts. Governor Newsom, the LAO, strongly have recommended against that, because that's for when you have a real downturn. And if you use that money now, when, yeah, it's not a great budget, but it's manageable, you're going to have real pain. So they put out their spending plan this week, and it's not as far left as the Senate Democrats' plan, but it's certainly on that track. And their priorities, you know, they want to have more money for childcare providers and give them a 25% cost of living adjustment, which is more than triple what Governor Newsom has proposed. They want to protect transit, which is on the chopping block for $1.2 billion in cuts in the Newsom plan. And interestingly, as we have talked about with the release of our upcoming study that we have on electric cars, and whether we'll be able to have the enough electricity to meet the additional demand, they want to cut funding for the energy grid, which is interesting because, you know, by all accounts, we're going to need to do a lot of infrastructure development and building specifically related to our electricity grid. And then it's obvious that the governor's plans that we were talking about last week for streamlining CEQA related to his priorities, which are primarily environmental areas and infrastructure, that's not going to go anywhere right now. And in fact, the assembly announced they're not going to have any hearings on it in the budget committee, and they're not going to have any hearings on it for a while, certainly related to the budget. And Newsom would like to pass those plans in relation to the budget. Bottom line, there are real, real differences between the governor and the assembly, and there are significant differences between the assembly and Senate. It's not a unified legislature, and we have about 20 days before they need to pass the budget, or else the legislators will lose their paychecks. So there's a little bit of caution. They just have to pass a budget by June 15th. That doesn't mean that's the budget that will actually be signed into law. The real deal is we have to have the budget signed by June 30th at midnight, or else, you know, then the spending stops at the stroke of midnight. So we will see what happens, but we're in for a very rocky few weeks, I think, of budget negotiations between Newsom and liberals in the legislature. And, you know, historically, certainly in the Jerry Brown era, the governor dominated the legislature when there were budget disagreements. We'll see what happens this year.
Well, legislators losing their paychecks. That's a very interesting thought, Tim. So let's move on to our podcast. You hosted the podcast. It's actually a webinar turned podcast for our viewers who are fans of the podcast. So Tim, how about introducing our guests?
Well, it's a really interesting discussion about California's out-migration problem. And it seems like you can't open a newspaper these days without seeing something about the problem growing worse. And of course, the poster child for that is the announcement that Nordstrom is going to leave the big mall in downtown San Francisco. And we thought, what a great discussion it could be to bring really the two minds on the free market side that are doing really out there research on California's out-migration problem. That's Dr. Lee Ohanian, who's a professor of economics at UCLA, and he's also with the Hoover Institution, and R. Wayne Winegarden, who's written extensively on our out-migration problem and has received national media attention for his work on this. So it's a really interesting discussion between the two of them on, you know, what the problem is now, how a lot of the problem is being made worse by policy mistakes at the state and local level, and then what can we do about it? So if you're interested in these kind of long nagging problems that are continue to grapple our state, I think you'll find this discussion very interesting.
I thought it was really terrific. I watched the webinar, and I think our listeners would really find this very interesting. So thanks, everyone, for listening.
Really excited. Dr. Ohanian, he's truly an expert on all things California and all things economics. Very, very distinguished career, professor of economics at UCLA. We were just chatting. He also professor of economics of sports. So I'm sure if you have any interesting sports questions, he would love to veer off into those topics as well. But today, what we really want to talk about is something really serious. California has been losing people for a long time now. we've actually lost a congressional seat, which is historic. So something is going on. And if we want to reverse it, if we want to regain that type of prosperity, we need to evaluate what's happened. And there's really no one better to do that discussion than Dr. Ohanian. So I'd like to turn the presentation over to him. And he's got some really great background remarks in terms of what's happening, give us perspective in terms of what's driving it, and eventually get us to the solutions. How do we reverse these declines?
Wayne, thanks so much for the introduction. I'm delighted to join you today and the folks who are tuning in. I'm going to go ahead and share the screen. I've got a few slides to show. And let me go ahead and get this full screen. Okay, so I'll show a few slides to set the stage for the theme of how I think about California. And I've been studying in detail California economics, economic policies for about the last 5 years. I write a weekly column called California on Your Mind, which is available on the Hoover Institution's website. I'll write typically every Tuesday. For example, the column I wrote this week was about San Francisco and how the value of its commercial office space has plummeted by 75% over the since the pandemic. So every Tuesday I typically write, and it's about a statewide or local of significance economic policy issue. So as Wayne, as you mentioned, California's population is declining. We've lost on net about 500,000 people since 2020. The theme of my presentation today is that people are leaving California because at a broad level, quality of life is just not competitive with other states for many Californians. California is one of only three states since 2010 to lose a seat in the House of Representatives, and analogously in the Electoral College. We're seeing the largest losses in California in some of the most expensive locations, and that gives a hint as to some of the reasons why people are leaving California. San Francisco has been hit particularly hard. San Francisco has lost 7.5% of its population since 2020. And to give you some context about that loss, the biggest city in the United States in the last 60 years that has declined is Detroit, Michigan. Detroit had about 1.7 million people at its peak, and sometime in the 1950s. It's declined to 600 and some odd thousand people today. So it's lost nearly two-thirds of its population over a 60-year period, but never did it lose 7.5% of its population over a 2 or 3 year period. In terms of quality of life and the expense of living in California, there are 13 million Californians who are on Medi-Cal, which is California's version of Medicaid. To give you an idea of just how those 13 million Californians struggle, a household of three, which is the median sized household in California, a household of three qualifies for Medi-Cal if their income is no more than $41,000 per year. And when one thinks about living for a family of three on $41,000 per year in California, particularly anywhere close to even moderate cost of living locations, that gives you an idea of just how difficult California has become, particularly for low and middle income people. And that 13 million Californians, that would be equivalent to the fifth largest state in the union, if those people did make up a state. And about the same number of people in California are living at or below or near the poverty line. Businesses are leaving as well. The business exit rate in the state is twice as high as before the pandemic. And the way I think about this is the businesses are leaving because at a broad level, cost of doing business in California is just uncompetitive with other states. And when we look at where they're going, they're going to states that typically are ranked as having more economic freedom, lower business costs, lower cost of living for their workers, which means it's easier and less expensive to hire qualified workers in states such as Texas and Utah and Tennessee and Florida than it is in California. And you know, there's sort of two types of businesses that are leaving. Some are very large businesses, very well established, and among those businesses whose headquarters have relocated include Elon Musk and Tesla, Hewlett Packard Enterprises, Oracle, Nestle's, Toyota, Charles Schwab, C.B. Richard Ellis Real Estate. Before that, Bank of America left. You've had a lot of large businesses who have exited. And it's not just the really big businesses, the well-established businesses, such as the ones we were just taking a look at. There's also a growing number of small, very rapidly growing companies that are leaving. And I have a report that's available on the Hoover website that goes into detail on businesses that have been leaving California and some of the reasons why. And it provides a complete listing. Here's just some of the potential unicorn type businesses that we've lost. So Maxar Technologies is a relatively new business, rapidly growing. They have unique satellite and radar technologies. They provide about 90% of radar and satellite intelligence to our Department of Defense. That business is almost certainly going to grow substantially in the future. They moved to Colorado. Envirotech Vehicles is a rapidly growing transportation company, and they are creating zero emission trucks, buses, and heavy equipment. California has talked about zero emissions cars by 2035. Buses, trucks, and heavy equipment are the next transportation vehicles that are going to be being pursued. And Envirotech has moved to Arkansas. And you can imagine just how big this market will be when we think about the need for trucks and buses and heavy equipment. So we've lost another rapidly growing business. Another one is Aqua Metals. Aqua Metals has a proprietary recycling technology for strategic and rare metals, including lithium, which goes into our cell phone batteries. And a huge issue that's going to be confronting us is shortages of metals and minerals such as lithium. Lithium comes primarily from African mines. Some of those mines have been purchased by China. So this is going to be a really important issue for us as we go forward. And we've lost Aqua Metals. Aqua Metals is also Colorado. So it's not just the big older companies such as Hewlett Packard and Oracle that have left, but also these potential unicorns that have left. And what is particularly striking to me is that these are all businesses that at some level are tech-related or have an important tech component to them. And California policymakers used to think, you know what, we're always going to have Silicon Valley. There's nothing like Silicon Valley in the rest of the country. No matter what we do, we're going to keep Silicon Valley. Well, Tesla and Oracle and Hewlett Packard and these smaller, rapidly growing businesses are testament to, no, we just can't count on Silicon Valley. We've got to make some policy changes, and I'll talk about those in a few minutes. So why are businesses and people leaving? So at the end of the day, at the foundation of this, I view this as really a failure of state governance and local governance. And so I'll cite some statistics that are really, in my opinion, the proximal reason why businesses and people are leaving. But at the end of the day, these, I believe, all can be tied to a failure of governance. So one is that California is expensive. California right now has an $818,000 median home price per the California Association of Realtors based on the most recent transactions. Only 20% of California households can afford this home. So 80% of the Californian households cannot afford this. But this statistic is somewhat misleading because to afford that $818,000 median home, one needs about $180,000 in liquid assets for the down payment and closing costs on a conventional mortgage. And for people who currently aren't homeowners, hardly anyone in the state has that type of cash. One reason California is so expensive is because we simply don't build very much. When Gavin Newsom was elected governor in 2018, his primary campaign promise was to build more housing. He talked about a Marshall Plan, referring back to the United States' enormous investments in Western and Northern Europe to help rebuild Europe after World War II. So how has that Marshall Plan worked out for California since Governor Newsom took office? It's been now over 4 years. Well, our construction is 83% below his goal, 83% below. And it's not just California. A lot of people I talk to often say, well, you know, there's the beaches and the mountains and the remarkable weather. Sure, housing's expensive. Well, and what I reply to them is, the beaches and the beautiful mountains and scenery and the remarkable weather has been with us forever, but we haven't had unaffordable housing forever. And in particular, during the really rapid growth years of California's California, which was between 1940 and 1970, the population grew from about 7 million to 20 million in that period of time, just remarkable growth. Throughout that period, California housing was only about 30% more expensive than the rest of the country. If that price premium prevailed today, the median home would not be $818,000. It would be closer to $400,000. Still an expensive home, but certainly much more affordable than $818,000. So what happened? Well, we have a panoply of environmental regulations and political dysfunction that blocked new developments and that raised building costs. I'll give you a couple of my favorite examples. In terms of blocking new developments, I'm going to refer to a project that's known as Tejon Ranch. And Tejon Ranch was a planned community for about 65,000 people. It was going to be about 35, 40 miles outside of Los Angeles, so you might consider it an LA bedroom community. So plans for Tejon Ranch were submitted in 1994. Nearly 30 years later, not one home has been built in Tejon Ranch. Who knows when a home will be built in Tejon Ranch, because in that nearly 30-year period, there have been environmental lawsuit after environmental lawsuit blocking that project. The people who own Tejon Ranch, and I believe has probably gone through a bankruptcy at some point. I don't believe the people who had that vision for building that 65,000 person community, I don't think they're even associated with the project anymore. I think they just simply couldn't afford to continue to finance it. The people who currently own it thought they were good to go of around 2019 when they agreed to a number of environmental demands. Well, today, just recently, new environmental demands have popped up. Okay, so 30 years later, we haven't built one home. I'll give you one other example. There's a fellow in San Francisco who is the owner of a building that housed a laundromat. The building had been constructed sometime in the 1960s. He wanted to convert that into high-density housing, leave a four-story apartment complex. That's exactly what San Francisco politicians stated they wanted. They wanted to fast track high density housing. Well, it took him 6 years and over $1.2 million in legal and permitting and other regulatory fees before he was allowed to create that high density housing. One of the last objections to that project came from one of the supervisors on San Francisco Board of Supervisors, who was worried that the four-story building would cast shade on the building right next door. So those are just two examples of how we shoot ourselves in the foot in terms of creating new housing within the state. And when we talk about quality of life, a big part of quality of life for families is having quality schooling. Well, our schools are failing, and they're failing at a substantial rate. These are the latest statistics. These are for 2022. And these statistics are based on targets provided by the U.S. Department of Education. California kids, and these are values for eighth graders. 84% lack proficiency in math. 79% lack proficiency in reading. 80% lack proficiency in science. So stop and think about that for a second. Some of you may have kids in the public school systems. This is simply abysmal. There's no other adjective to describe this. 80% of our kids can't read. They don't understand math. They don't understand science. There's only two states in the country worse than California, which are Alabama and New Mexico. California once had the best schools in the country back in the day, back in the 1960s. What happened? Well, our politicians tolerate poor performance. Why is that? Well, we'll possibly get into that in my conversation with Wayne and perhaps in your questions, but there's a very expensive, huge political nexus associated with the education system, including educational unions. And there's a lot of support for incumbent politicians by that educational system. And in turn, they seem to have the back of those who are failing us. And I'll just give you one quick example that will really drive this home. Back in 2012, a lawsuit was filed by a bunch of kids, middle schoolers and high schoolers. And these were almost all Hispanic kids. And they sued the state of California on an equal protection grounds of the U.S. Constitution, stating that they were tired of getting a lousy education. And the lawsuit went to trial. The trial judge, in his opinion, based on testimony from experts in the areas of the economics of education, he wrote in his opinion that the statistics presented, and we're looking at some of these statistics right here, they were not only compelling, but they were chilling. And so what he did in his opinion, he struck down teacher tenure within public K through 12. He struck down seniority-based pay. He struck down seniority-based layoff policies. This was a nuclear bomb going off in our public K through 12 system. Well, less than 48 hours after he ruled in this trial, Kamala Harris, who is then Attorney General for California, filed an appeal. Okay. And I had hoped that this would be a little bit of a come to Jesus moment for state politicians and the state educational system to say, we can't do this anymore. We've got to get better. That never happened, because here we are 10 years later and we see the statistics. And what happened? And that was that lawsuit was called Vergara et al. Versus State of California. The state appellate court rejected the original trial court opinion, stating that they agreed poor kids were getting lousy educations, but they didn't see it as an equal protection lawsuit case. It went to the state, went to our state Supreme Court. On that five justice panel of our state Supreme Court, three voted not to hear the case. Those who voted to hear the case wrote statements that were incredibly compelling about just how badly we're training our children. And of course, this really punishes low-income families who can't afford to live in high-quality school districts or afford private schools. Why else are people leaving? Well, we pay a lot in taxes and we're not really getting very much for that. California used to invest 25% of the budget, 25% of the budget in capital investment. Today it's about 4%. We haven't had a major water infrastructure investment in the last 50 years. Most storm drainage was constructed before 1940, and we had an incredibly rainy season this past winter. And we know just how much was cost, and there were loss of life because of flooding. We have fewer serviceable, we have fewer miles of serviceable roads than we had in 1990. We don't adequately mitigate wildfire risks. The campfire alone, and the campfire, I believe, was in 2022, the campfire alone cost $422 billion in total economic costs. $422 billion. That's about 2 years of the state budget in a normal year. And ironically, to put this into context, all that California has done to reduce carbon emissions in the last 20 years, all of the expensive regulations and tax credits that have been applied have been offset by carbon emissions from wildfires. And that statement doesn't take into account the enormous particulate emissions coming from these wildfires. And particulate emissions are one of the leading causes of death throughout. I'll give you one more example. If you were following the story about what happened in California during COVID, obviously because we locked down a lot of businesses, there's a massive increase in unemployment. As our state unemployment office was deluged with claims, $32 billion of fraud occurred. As convicted felons applied and successfully received unemployment benefits, one resident successfully filed 60 different claims for unemployment insurance. A person impersonating Senator Dianne Feinstein received unemployment benefits. $32 billion of fraud. How did that happen? We've got a 40-plus-year-old IT system. In the world of technology, that's Jurassic Park. Businesses, why are they leaving? Well, they face the 49th highest tax burden in the U.S., and that's per the Tax Foundation, which is a nonpartisan, high-quality research foundation in Washington, D.C. All they do is study tax issues. CEOs have spoken loudly. They rank California invariably as the worst state for running a business, and what they refer to are taxes, regulations, the cost of doing business, and an adversarial public sector, both at the state and local level. The American Legislative Exchange Council is a research institution, ranks California 45th in terms of the quality of state economic policies. So what needs to be done? We need better governance, full stop. We need better governance. And where does that start? Well, that starts with having incentives and accountability present within state and local government. There's very few incentives for state workers to succeed. And there's very few incentives against state workers not doing their job. Accountability. We need accountability. There needs to be accountability for the failure to build houses at a reasonable cost. We need accountability for a failed public school system. We need accountability for failing infrastructure. Right now, I would love to hear from you if you can tell me where you've heard a public official saying, "My bad, we haven't been accountable. We need to do a better job." So with that, let me go ahead and turn over to Wayne with some additional questions. I look forward to your comments. And again, I'm delighted to be part of this. Pacific Research Institute is a wonderful organization. They do superb work on analyzing state and local economic policy issues. And I'm delighted to have this opportunity.
Lee, thank you so much. That was fantastic, fantastic and chilling. I like that term you use. Chilling all at the same time. If I can start kind of trying to give you a little pushback, because while those stats are chilling and you would think, well, based on that there'd be an emergency, right? There'd be some sort of fire in the belly of our governor and our legislature to change this. But what you get, and perhaps this is part of his presidential campaign, but what you get in response is, well, OK, California is the fifth largest economy in the world, and we're about to overtake Germany. We're about to be the fourth largest economy. We grew faster for the past 10 years, and last year maybe a little slower, but our economy is growing faster. We're becoming the fourth largest one. We have higher incomes. So this out-migration, it's inconsequential. And so I guess, what's wrong with that argument? If they're putting that out there, are they right? And if so, you know, if not, what's wrong?
Yeah. So really, there's two points I'd like to make in response. One is that California has become a state of the haves and the have-nots. It's a remarkable state. There remains remarkable economic success here, but there's just far too many people that are struggling. So what the governor doesn't talk about is the 13 million people on Medi-Cal. He doesn't talk about 13 million people living under or near the poverty line. And what he doesn't talk about is the statistics about income growth. That isn't adjusted for inflation. So there's a lot of inflation going on in California that's not being captured in those statistics. To give you a statistic that's that provides some evaluation for inflation, the number of people working in California today, or at least our most recent data, which I believe is March of 2023, the number of people working in our state in March of 2023 is about the same as the number of people working in December of 2018. So from the standpoint of jobs, we haven't grown at all. We simply haven't grown at all. And our recovery in terms of jobs from the pandemic is among the worst in the country. And that's not to say that we don't have some remarkable individuals, some remarkable job creators, some remarkable corporations, that Silicon Valley doesn't remain an economic powerhouse. It's not to say that. It's to say that we're making life too difficult for those 13 million people, probably closer to 20 million people if we take into account all the people who aren't at the poverty level, but who are still struggling very mightily. And is to say that, hey, we wish we had Elon Musk back here. We wish we had Tesla and Oracle and Hewlett-Packard Enterprises. We wish we had Aqua Minerals. We wish we had Envirotech Vehicles back here. And so there's a lot to love about California. None of us want to leave. I've lived in California except for graduate school. And when I first started my teaching career, I started at the University of Pennsylvania, and then I moved to the University of Minnesota before going to UCLA. in terms of a place to live, it's hard to find some place that's better. But I wish the governor would step back for a second and stop talking about Donald Trump and stop berating Governor Abbott and Governor DeSantis and say, you know, we can do better here. We should be worried about people and businesses are leaving, and we should do better, and we can do better, and we will do better. And one of the areas where he made some substantial campaign promises is housing, and we are 83% below that goal, and that's not something that he's talking about.
I used to work with Dina Arduin, who was Governor Schwarzenegger's budget director, and what she used to say, and I think what you're saying is consistent with that, that if you look at the elasticity of the state, that people will put up with a lot to live in California. It's a very inelastic, as us economists might say, to these problems. But that it's not perfectly inelastic, that you will eventually drive people out. We can have worse policies in Minnesota because we don't have Minnesota winters, but eventually you convince people to leave, which is interesting. When we were talking about housing affordability, which to me is something I focus on. And one of the areas that's really important is CEQA, which is the California Environmental Quality Act, right along with what you were talking about. And what's interesting, Tim and I mentioned this, that the governor's going to come out with a proposal to reform CEQA. He may be doing that as we're talking. I'm sure the governor is not going to reform the way you said he should, but how should he be reforming CEQA? What can we do to lower that environmental burden that's keeping Tejon from building any houses at all?
Right. So CEQA has been, in my opinion, and within people within the construction industry, including attorneys who represent the building industry. Sorry, my dog is barking here. Jennifer Hernandez is a tireless advocate. She's an attorney. She's a tireless advocate for reforming CEQA. She has done some of the best work in analyzing CEQA-based lawsuits. And what she has found is that an awful lot of these lawsuits are targeted by groups that simply pretend to be friends of the environment. So one of the reforms that to me makes an awful lot of sense is transparency. We should understand when a CEQA-based lawsuit is filed, we should understand who is filing that. More often than not, groups that create a shell organization called Friends of the River or Friends of the California Environment oftentimes are a labor union that wants to be part of a development, oftentimes are community groups that want to get part of the surplus that's created by new development. So transparency is, it seems like an obvious reform. I don't know who would object to that, but that's been on the table for years. Another issue that I think makes a lot of sense is eliminating duplicative lawsuits. So the same lawsuit can be filed time and again within CEQA. That's one of the reasons why Tejon Ranch has been delayed for, and when you think about it, it's been delayed for nearly 30 years. That's one of the reasons behind that delay is duplicative lawsuits. Another reform, I think, is the losing party should be liable for court costs, which is the standard approach in civil lawsuits. I think those are all there for the taking. They're not partisan, in my view. They're kind of common sense economic efficiency arguments that has longstanding bases in trial law. And those have been there for the taking for years. And Governor Newsom has been governor for 4 years now. He's got super, super majorities in the Assembly and in the Senate. And why hasn't this been done before? And a big reason is that, and I'm not being partisan here, but those who were in power in state politics are very much embedded within the powerful California environmental lobby. And they do not want to upset that apple cart. So when we ask, CEQA has been a problem for decades. Why haven't we seen those reforms? Because there's a political cost that politicians would pay if they went against those environmental interests. And when I talk to people who are environmental backers, I'll often say, we can do a lot better job protecting the environment if we reform CEQA. Just look at the enormous damage to the state from the storms and the floods we've had. One of the reasons why we haven't done a better job of protecting those environments is because it's too hard to do that. We haven't mitigated wildfire risk. A lot of that has been either based on lawsuits or the threat of environmental lawsuits. I think about the folks up near the Monterey Bay area, the Pajaro levee, which breached a couple of months ago. And that levee has flooded numerous times since it was constructed in 1960. It received a federal environmental review clearance about 10 years ago. The reason the federal environmental review clearance was issued is because the Army Corps of Engineers is part of the complex issue of shoring up the levee, and everyone involved agrees that this will be a much better environmental outcome. And you look at the flooding that occurred and the massive losses that occurred with that Pajaro levee breaking, and you say this wasn't good for the environment. This could have been resolved if for example, we had just said, the federal environmental review came back with flying colors. Let's go with that. Let's go with that and let's resolve this. We could have done that years ago, but instead we've waited. We're waiting for the California environmental review to be completed. And so I think there's just a lot of common sense that can be implemented in environmental reviews that for, I think, true environmentalists that who don't have a political agenda, who simply want to preserve environment in a sensible and realistic way without wasting a ton of money, I think it's just, I think there's money on the table right there. But too often there's a political agenda. And again, I wish somebody in the governor's office or the assembly or the Senate would say, you know what? I don't care if I get voted out. This is important to the state. This is important to future generations. And I'm going to go to the mat on this issue. If there's someone knows along those lines, I'd love to hear about it, and I'll interview them for my next column.
Well, and it's almost trying to convince them what actually, you know, what we can practically achieve in terms of environmentalism. Like you said, it's a better environmental policy. Something I believe is correct, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but like the Colorado River, right? And we're having all sorts of water right issues because all these states are drawing down the river, a huge environmental issue. If we would, you said 4%, which that shocked me. I didn't realize it's that low. 4% of our budget is capital investments. If we would invest in our water infrastructure, capture more of our water, we wouldn't need to draw on the Colorado River. And that in and of itself would resolve the problem. So if we would just invest in our water resources, we could environmentally save the Colorado River. Is that overdramatic?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think that would certainly go a long ways towards supporting that ecosystem. And again, that's what environmentalists want. And Senator Feinstein, a Democrat, again, this is not a partisan issue. It's just a common sense functionality issue. Senator Feinstein noted California hasn't had a major water investment since the California Water Project was completed in 1973. And by the way, it never was completed according to the vision of those who designed it back in the 1950s. It never went as far as it was supposed to go. And so you look at California's agricultural industry, and they're dealing with, they have to plan for, is there going to be drought? Do I tear up my almond trees? Do I plant something less water intensive? There's a lot of uncertainty that goes along with that. And again, environmental lawsuits deluge any substantial water investment project. The twin tunnels that Jerry Brown talked about were on the table, and those were hit with enormous pushback from the environmental lobby. Newsom talked about a single tunnel. We have the Sacramento and San Francisco deltas, which involves some endangered species. My favorite story about that was that I think back in, I think it was back in 2015 or 16, we had a drought year, and there were I think maybe three or four steelhead trout that were caught in the river, and there simply wasn't enough water to carry them upstream. And so I thought, when I heard about this story in the news, I thought, you know what? Get a big aquarium, catch those gals and guys, and put them in that big aquarium, and then drive them to the point of the river where they can get out and spawn. But instead, I think enough water was pulsed into the river, and so much water had to be pulsed that I think it was probably enough to satisfy a city of the size of San Jose for about half a year to save, well, who knows whether they were saved or not? I can imagine that that rush of water may not have been very friendly for those steelhead trout. So there are those things that just simply don't make any sense. So I would love to think that with the right leadership, and again, this goes back to the issue about California schools. Our political leaders have to say, we need to fix this, and you're going to have to work with me on this. And If I get voted out because you push back on me, then I'm going to get voted out. But if I can get enough people, enough of my colleagues here in the assembly or the Senate, if I get enough people working with me, you're going to have to work with us, and let's make it a better tomorrow. And we can create a more successful environment. This one, what we're doing now simply is not working. Everybody knows it. So let's roll up our sleeves and get to work.
Speaking of that, one of the issues I've been looking a lot into, you can't, you walk anywhere, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and the thing you notice is the homeless issue, which is also, we haven't touched on this yet, but that's just a huge driver. In your mind, you know, how do we start to get our arms around this problem? Because it's truly awful when just from a human perspective, but also from an economic perspective.
Oh, absolutely. We are spending enormous amounts on homelessness just in the city of San Francisco. By the end of this fiscal year, which will be June 30th of 2023, the 4 years up to June 30th, 2023, San Francisco will have spent $4 billion on dealing with homelessness. There's more homeless in San Francisco than there ever been before. So I think the number one issue to confront with that many in the state have been unwilling to recognize is the chronic homelessness, you know, month after month, is really people who have mental health challenges, physical health challenges, drug abuse, substance abuse challenges. And, you know, there's a terrific book by Michael Schellenberger called San Francisco for people who want to read about this. Interesting guy. I did a panel discussion with him. It's on YouTube for people. If people Google my name and Michael Schellenberger, we did a panel discussion along with Kevin Kiley, really talented legislature. He's now in our House of Representatives, about homelessness. Schellenberger used to be about as liberal as one can get, super left. Kevin Kiley is a Republican. They agreed pretty much on 95% of what to do, which is these people, the chronically homeless, we've got to provide them humane treatment. We need to get them off the streets. We need to get them into treatment. If they simply can't be allowed to create a de facto home in the middle of San Francisco, simply is unacceptable. And that's a big component of our chronic homelessness. We have a lot of shelters that go unused. We do a pretty good job for cases such as there's a family and something happens within that family and a parent and the kids have to leave. We do a pretty good job of providing support for those people who are homeless. But only now is California, and not all legislators are understanding, hey, this is about substance abuse. It's about mental health. Only this year has there been enough political will to even have an audit over the spending, over state spending on homelessness. So it's a huge issue. It's a costly issue. California is among the worst states on a per capita basis in terms of number of psychiatric beds, psychiatrists, nurses to support these folks. One thing I'm really happy that Governor Newsom has done is he's talked about the importance of trying to get these folks off the street, trying to change our conservatorship laws. So I'm all in favor of that because what we're seeing now is just a devastating loss of life that is not serving anyone well. And again, we should do better. We can do better.
Well, I'm going to jump in on that point and ask some of the questions that our audience members have been sending in. And this is a question from Karen. She wanted to know, how does in-migration to California balance out in any way the out-migration that we're seeing? Is there any data on that?
Sure. Yeah. So every state loses people every year, and every state gains people every year. What we're seeing in California is that the outflow has exceeded the inflow by about, more than 500,000, given that given that births are still exceeding deaths. So, to kind of put that in perspective, we grew from 7 million to 20 million between 1940 to 1970. We peaked at about 39.5 million in 2020. We're now at about 39 million. So yes, we have people coming in. We have people leaving. A lot of the people, one of the narratives that's being painted by Governor Newsom and others is that, well, you know, and Governor Newsom acknowledges we have a housing problem. And he paints a narrative that, you know, middle income, low income people are leaving the state. Well, when we look at the data from the IRS of who's leaving San Francisco, it's really wealthy households. People with, you know, the median income of those leaving California per IRS records based on where they're filing their taxes from, I think it's about $250,000 disposable income per year. Those are wealthy households. Where are they going to establish their new residences? Jackson Hole, Wyoming, Lake Tahoe, Miami Beach. So it's not that we're just losing, you know, low-income people that can't afford to live here. We're losing very high-income people as well. So yes, people are coming in, but those coming in are now much less than those going out. And we can, and because of California's natural attributes, there's some simple things we can do to stop that. And I certainly hope that state policymakers take up that challenge soon.
One thing to add to that also, when you lose a high-income household, people have to remember top 0.1% provide 40% of the tax revenues. So just it takes just a few of those ultra-wealthy households to leave to have a real dent on the tax revenues for the state, which really creates budget crises. So there's an important perspective on losing those high-end households.
That's so important. There are a few thousand tax filers within the state who have seven-figure tax bills, and those who are at risk for is they have the financial wherewithal to establish residence somewhere else. They'll probably keep a California home or more than one California home, but they're at risk of moving to other places. So we can't afford to lose. I wish the governor would say, thank you so much. Thank you for your business. Thanks for supporting Sacramento. Let's try to make life a little bit easier for you. But yeah, there's a huge risk at that. And California, more than any other state, depends on the very, 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 very top for personal income tax revenue. And it's a high wire act that I wish we would get away from.
Another question, when we're talking about, you know, the reasons that people were giving for leaving the state, this question, what about the rise in property and violent crime? You know, this questioner figures that must be a reason for folks also leaving. And is there a way to address this?
Yeah, crime rates, particularly property crime rates, are up, certainly in our biggest cities. San Francisco, I wrote a recent column about this. San Francisco, in terms of overall crime rate, both property and violent crime, is among the top 2% in terms of highest crime in the country. And a big reason behind that is property crime, break-ins in cars. There's been a lot of stories on the media about retail theft in San Francisco. There's a story that sort of went viral when Whole Foods closed down in downtown San Francisco due to concerns about employee safety and the fact that people were coming into Whole Foods and going to the restrooms and using them as drug shooting salons. I believe there was people were found passed out from an opioid overdose on the floors of Whole Foods restrooms. Again, there's this relationship between drug abuse and homelessness and crime within our major cities. It's related in the sense that I think you need policies to address all these things. We can't tolerate crime. We can't tolerate homelessness. And we need to provide these people with support and medical treatment. And if we do that, things will get an awful lot better. But we still have tent cities. We still allow people to live on sidewalks, to use drugs out on the street. One of my best friends took he lives up near San Francisco. He took his daughter for a birthday lunch, his adult daughter for birthday lunch up in San Francisco. They parked their car in a parking garage. It was probably about $25. And they walked out, and right there is a person. There is a person shooting up. It's just not a functional society. It's not partisan. It's not a left or right issue. This is just not a way a society can function. function. So we address homelessness and drug abuse. Crime is addressed as part of that as well.
Our Dan Kolke has a question. He also has some great ideas for CEQA reform that I will make sure to share with you, Lee, offline. So he asks, what do you think accounts for the significant increase in homelessness, even as the economy grew in the 2018 to 20 period before the pandemic, and even as the government expanded benefits during the pandemic?
Certainly, state government, federal government providing support to the state, a lot of dollars were available to try to help keep people who became unemployed in their homes. COVID was part of that. We've also had, you know, an increase in drug abuse. And again, the chronically homeless tend to be about 70%, 75% are those with drug abuse, emotional health issues. That seems to have increased within the state. I don't think the data exists to indicate whether that's people coming in to the state from other locations. I suspect it is because in Schellenberger's book, San Francisco, he talks to addicts. He talked to, you know, a couple of hundred people there. And a lot of them said, yeah, I came from Seattle. I came from Portland. I came from some other place because here in San Francisco, I get $600 or $700 of walk around money every month. He has a video of one fellow who talks about how, hey, the city basically pays me to be homeless. And he talks about getting, I think, $600 or $700 a month of support. He says, I got Netflix on my iPhone, and very sad statement. He says, I supplement my income by teaching kids how to use fentanyl to get high, but not to kill themselves. So again, this is kind of a basic economic story about incentives. I think the money is there. I think we just have to change our policy goals and the way we implement those policies. There are people who are struggling to live in California because of high housing costs. When I talk about affordable housing, I put quote marks about, around that, because right now San Francisco is renovating apartments, you know, 400 square foot apartments, just renovating them at a cost of $1 million per apartment. So just how do you get your head around spending $1 million to renovate a one bedroom apartment? In LA, we are building 300 square foot studio units for, I think, $837,000 per unit. And that was the number from about 3 years ago. It's probably well over $900,000 today. So when you think about that, you almost, either you say, this is nuts. And again, if I get back to the idea of accountability, there's no one in state and local government who's saying, something's wrong. Something's terribly wrong. If we're spending $1 million to renovate a one-bedroom apartment, hey, stop the presses. Let's figure this out. We should and can do better. I hate to say it, but everybody would be much better off if we simply wrote people, low-income people, a check to say, you're struggling here in California. You're probably never going to be able to buy a home. Here's a check. You know, move to someplace in the Midwest. You can buy a home for much less, a single family home with a decent school and a garden. You can do that for much less than we can house you in some little cramped apartment. So that's got to change as well.
So last question, this comes from Walter, and he has kind of a, you know, given all that we've talked about today and all the challenges that we have with government and things not going in the right direction here, he asks, what can we do to get, you know, more Californians to understand the failings of our current government and demand action from their elected officials for change?
Yeah, that's the $69,000 question. A reason why I'm happy to participate in events like today and I write op-eds is that so people get a better sense of the failings, of the dysfunction at the state and the local government level, because they simply don't know. Some will know if it's close enough, such as, hey, you know what, I'm paying my taxes, but the potholes on my street, they still haven't been paved over. Or a business owner will say, I just got hit by a lawsuit that I wouldn't have gotten hit by if I lived in another state. But issues such as our schools are horribly dysfunctional, people don't know that. Issues such as we're spending $1 million to renovate a one-bedroom apartment, people don't know that. Issues such as we haven't built new major water infrastructure for 50 years, people don't know that. And I wish the media, the mainstream media, they get to connect with a lot more people than we do. I wish they would start to write those stories. To give an example, Governor Newsom just decided to stop repaying a $20 billion loan from the federal government to shore up our unemployment benefit system because we permitted $32 billion in fraud. That we've defaulted on a federal loan of $20 billion. That's not getting reported. Interestingly enough, someone wrote to me and said, I wrote a column about this. Somebody wrote to me and said, hey, your column is front page in Russia. because Putin loves to see that kind of stuff. He says, hey, look at the crazy stuff going on in the United States. That didn't get written up here in our state. And until voters demand change and demand more value for their tax dollars, this year's budget was $20,000 per house. Our state budget was $20,000 per household, $20,000. I wish people would stop and think, did I get my $20,000 worth? How's my kid's school performing? You know, am I stuck in traffic because we haven't expanded our transportation infrastructure? Can I afford to buy a house? Voters have got to demand more. But Walter, you're absolutely right. I sometimes joke that people are struggling so much to take care of their kids and to work two jobs and to try to find a way to save some money for a house that all this stuff just passes them over. And sometimes people are think, hey, you know what? This is just the cost of living in California with beaches and mountains and the beautiful scenery and the fact that it's 75 degrees every day, you know, 300 days out of the year. But it doesn't have to be this way. It didn't used to be this way. And I'll just say in closing that during those go-go years, an awful lot of investments in water, schools, hospitals, colleges, highways, roads were done under Jerry Brown. Pat Brown, Jerry Brown's dad, when Pat Brown was governor back in the early and mid 1960s, he was a Democrat. He used to say things like, we can't abuse the taxpayer. We've got to invest in the future. All these people want to come to California and live here. We're going to welcome them and we're going to build the schools and the hospitals and colleges and transportation infrastructure that they need. And we're going to welcome this. And they did it on a budget that was 14% inflation adjusted per person of today's budget. All of those all of that building that California did back in the day was on an inflation adjusted per person basis of 14% of what we spend today, adjusted for inflation per capita. We should be able to do an awful lot better. But until voters demand that, I worry that we're just going to see more of the same.
If you like this episode, please tell your friends and subscribe to PRI's podcast at iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. And when you're on these platforms, don't forget to give us a big 5 stars. If you don't subscribe to any of these, you can still listen on PRI's YouTube page, youtube.com/PacificResearch1. That's the number 1. Thanks for listening. I'm Rowena Ichon. Hope you'll come back again for next round with PRI.